I'd like to introduce Pauline Conroy, who is one of our veteran four-decade-long activists for reproductive justice and reproductive rights in Ireland, going back to the 60s, and is a social scientist and an author, and has done work recently on rape and incest as a ground in abortion law, and previously in 83 led the only successful constituency no vote on the 1983 amendment, which is very important to say out loud and record, and also has worked on issues of mental health and child abuse. So thank you, Paul.
Thank you very much. I want to talk about the beginning for a few moments and bring you back to 1923, when the state was being founded. And smoke was still rising from burnt out buildings and creameries, and executed bodies in the country had scarcely been buried after the Civil War, and the Civil War was continuing on. But the most urgent task facing the victors was punishment. Punishment, for example, of those who persisted in showing silent movies. Silent movies that would inculcate principles contrary to public morality, or would be otherwise subversive of public morality, that would be indecent, obscene, or blasphemous. So we start out with the foundation of the state concerned with silent movies. And they were concerned because these images were going to be available to hundreds of thousands of illiterate persons, most of whom had no electricity at home, and if they went to the cinema, this was going to be a big deal. So in 1923, this was not the only attack on the quality of life of women. There was also the case of the Galway workhouse, where unmarried mothers, by law, were to be divided into two classes. First offenders, literally, to be dealt with in the same institution as children, and the old offenders to be sent to the Magdalen Asylum. And any who refuse to enter such institutions as may be selected shall not be allowed under any circumstances to become chargeable to the public rates. They were to be rendered destitute. And that was also in the local government temporary provisions of 1923. So even before the state had managed to declare emergency powers to actually regulate the running of the state, they had started outcasting women. And I think this is the deep and inculcated and heavily legitimized set of attitudes that we are trying to undermine now by repealing the Eighth Amendment. And it goes back deep. Now, others have also mentioned that in the last century, in the 1940s, with England involved in a Second World War, women in Ireland could not get to England, either to have their babies and give them up for adoption, or avail of the limited scale of abortion that was there from 1938. And we sometimes forget that abortion law in England does not date back to 1967. It dates back much earlier, in the case of Dr. Alec Bourne, who was tried under the 1861 Act for performing an abortion on a raped 14-year-old girl who had been gang raped by soldiers. He then presented himself to his local police station and was duly prosecuted. And this introduced an amendment to the then 1861 Act, an amendment though that was problematic for its implementation across the countries of the United Kingdom. And the response to the fact that women couldn't get off this island was a soaring rise in backstreet abortion. And we know this because cases were prosecuted, cases were tried of arrested practitioners. They were reported on in the Irish Times very prominently, day after day. And they arranged from organised but illegal abortion clinics in Merrion Square, Mount Street, or Parkgate Street, right through to rural women offering assistance to local neighbours. So it was all classes of women. And that backstreet abortion continued even after the war was ended and right up to the passage of the 1967 Abortion Act. And following that, Irish women north and south took to the boats immediately availing of others' legislation to maximum effect. And I think perhaps the availability of pregnancy termination in England has somewhat softened our approach to establishing a level playing field for women and men in Ireland over the intervening decades, until Deputy Claire Daly broke that unbroken line of allowing all to be expelled to England. And her act marked the end, really, of an era. It was the introduction into the Oireachtas of the dreadful deed, abortion. And now we have a crisis in the case of reproduction. And we have a crisis because the A, B and C cases obliged the government to clarify the conditions under which a termination could take place in Ireland. We have a crisis because the late Savita Halappanavar drew attention to the quality of care provided to pregnant women in the course of a miscarriage. And we have a crisis because one young woman failed to get out of Ireland in time to terminate a pregnancy forced on her by rape, and a birth forced on her by the state. Now, there are supposed to be guidelines on how to implement our latest production in the field of reproductive non-rights. And that's the draft, 108 pages of guidelines, which were supplied to me, I don't know about others, but kindly, by the Guardian newspaper. And we were faced with what to do. What does a nurse or health professional do when she is presented with a woman or girl child seeking a pregnancy termination? Well, she has to read through and be familiar with the 108 pages. So I said, what on earth requires 108 pages? So I had to look to see what are the guidelines for running the country. And the guidelines are the standing orders of the Dáil, and that's 106 pages. So actually running this act is the same as running a country. I want to mention what I would call creeping foetalism. And my colleague Ursula Barry has dwelt on this in a paper last year. And I noticed with horror that the Advanced Care Directive Bill that came before the Dáil decided to insert a clause which would deny women, pregnant women, the right to have their Advanced Care Directive views met. And how was this done? Well, if, for example, a woman had written an Advanced Care Directive and she was, say, 37 years old, she gets into a car, it crashes, she's taken to hospital, she's in a coma. So people start saying, did she have an Advanced Care Directive written up? And the answer is yes. So they go and fetch it. But they then discover she's pregnant. She didn't know she was pregnant. It's an early pregnancy. So at that point, they tear up the Advanced Care Directive. And the Advanced Care Directive, the rights of the woman are transferred to the High Court, not to her doctor, not to the specialist, but to the High Court, will then decide the fate of her body. I find that really diminishing and discriminating and disgraceful. So I took part in the consultation and wrote that I thought that this was a complete denial of the autonomy and dignity of the human person. Now, asylum seekers, as we've heard so ably from Akidwa, who are children, and who have arrived in Ireland pregnant, as many do, have been allowed to go to England for abortions. And the Department of Foreign Affairs and their UK counterparts do arrange the exit and entry visas from Ireland and the exit and entry visas in and out of England. And social work staff in Ireland are allowed and permitted to accompany such a child to the UK. But what happens to the asylum seekers who are not children, who arrive in Ireland and discover they are pregnant? Well, in the case of conflict rape, the UN High Commissioner for Refugees Guidelines identifies a category of woman who is at risk or at high risk or heightened risk, and that these risk statuses should be invoked. It is now the gender policy of the UN High Commission for Refugees, as I understand it, not to treat all women asylum seekers and refugees as a vulnerable category, because that would be to deny them the self-determining status of their position as women, but rather to target those women who are at heightened risk. And that heightened risk is not to be inherent to the woman, but the heightened risk of the external factors, such as militias or violent groups who could impinge on her life. So such a girl or woman can be accompanied to the UN High Commissioner for Refugees in Dublin on the basis of having been raped in a situation of violence or conflict, or having a reason to believe that there will be retaliation against her for being pregnant. But the focus would be on the rape. And the UN High Commissioner for Refugees offices in Dublin actually does take up and provide information in a limited number of cases, although its job is to be a general oversight to government policy. Perhaps in some instances we should spend less time looking at wombs and more time looking at the legal status of women in a human rights context. It's argued by anti-choice supporters that abortion in Ireland is now allowed up to the moment of birth. And in a way it's true to an extent. And that's because the Eighth Amendment is worded that way, that's because that law of 2013 is worded that way. I didn't word it that way, you didn't word it that way. It's their amendment. Let us restore women's autonomy to the Constitution and repeal the Eighth Amendment.